break it down.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
Break it down.
Game was a bit of a heart attack and a half, but Jesus Christ, man, this defense is just giving this fan base heart attacks for the last month. Like, I mean, at the end of the day, I think a lot of people were sleeping on the Saints a little bit. I was not one of those people. I knew the Saints were gonna keep it close, but I knew the Lions, but I had no doubts the Lions were gonna win this week. Just the Saints made it a worry, baby. That's just the Lions, you know. They were able to weather the storm and survive a scare from the Saints, you know. I'll be honest, there was a reason why I had the Saints winning the NFC South, though, at the preseason. And the Saints are pretty much proved why today. But before we talk about what happened with the Lions and Saints game today, we need to take a look at everything else that happened this week.
Detroit basketball!
So we had the Pistons play this weekend. Yeah, the Pistons have just been bad. Like, at this point, less said about the Pistons, the better. Like, it's another week, and the Pistons continue to add to their historic losing streak at now 17 games in a row. Jesus Christ, this is getting fucking embarrassing. Alright, bad enough the Pistons went the entire month of November without winning. So yeah, the Pistons really gave No Win November a new meaning. Jesus fucking Christ, it's a meaning that nobody wanted to see in Detroit. And a meaning in Detroit that nobody asked for. Like, Jesus Christ, it's fucking sad how bad this rebuild is going. Like, the Pistons have clearly done it the wrong way. Like, this is year four of this rebuild. And the Pistons have gone backwards instead of forwards. Like, the Pistons should be moving forward at this point in the rebuild, and they've gone backwards, and there's no excuses for it this year. Like, I'll be perfectly honest with how the Pistons have played. I think there's a very strong chance Troy Weaver gets fired midseason at this rate. Because Monty Williams, he fucking looks like he regrets fucking being in Detroit and taking the deal. Like, the Pistons honestly have no fucking clue what they're doing. It's a fucking embarrassment. It's a fucking shit show. Like, at this point in the rebuild, I'll just say this. This fucking fan base does not deserve this many years of fucking losing in a row. Like, just the Pistons are absolute fucking garbage. But yeah, I guess the Pistons being garbage this year, it's what we had to sacrifice for the Lions to be good this year. And to have a shot at potentially doing something in the playoffs. Soul for a soul. Hey, at least we didn't have to sacrifice the Red Wings in the trade-off, so I think sacrificing the Pistons for the Lions, I think it's a fair trade-off. At least we didn't have to sacrifice the Red Wings so the Wings can be good too. Honestly, I'd rather we'd sacrifice the Tigers instead of the Pistons. But beggars can't be choosers. And for everybody saying for Tom Gore to sell the team, just chill for a second. Because if Tom Gore sells the team, there's no fucking guarantees the next owner is going to be good or not. Because if Tom Gore sells the team, it will more than likely be to Chris Illich, who owns the Red Wings and the Pistons and the Tigers. Like, the only way, like, if Tom Gore sells the Pistons, there's a good chance the Pistons might relocate. Especially since how the Pistons have had massive attendance issues for, like, the last decade, especially ever since coming back to the Detroit at Little Caesars Arena. Like, the only way the Pistons stay in Detroit under new ownership is if either Chris Illich buys the team or if Sheila Ford Hamp buys the team. And for Chris Illich, well, Chris Illich, it's a mixed bag what you get with Chris. Because on one end with the Tigers, he's very hands-on, and Tigers are just an absolute fucking mess, mediocre mess. While with the Red Wings, the Wings are only where they are right now is because Steve Yzerman told Chris to piss off and to let him do his fucking job. Yeah, that's just the difference here. One team that he's hands-on with is a complete mess. The one he's not hands-on with is contending with the Lions for number one sports team in Detroit right now. So yeah, it all really depends if he's hands-on or not. If he's hands-on, the Pistons are going nowhere. If he's hands-off and he buys the Pistons, then the Pistons might have a shot. But honestly, I probably prefer Sheila Ford Hamp to buy the Pistons off Gores, if anything. Because, hey, Sheila's done a good job turning the Lions around, so maybe she can turn the Pistons around, too. I mean, she's done a good job so far, especially mending some broken bridges, too. Who knows? Maybe she could have a chance to do it. Time will tell there. But, yeah, just an embarrassing for the Pistons. Like, the fan base deserves fucking better than this crap. Just fucking embarrassing overall. For the Pistons. Honestly, less said about it, the better. But yeah, easily Pistons are the worst team in basketball right now, and it's rightfully deserved. So, now to the Red Wings, as the Wings have returned from their trip from Sweden, which they looked inconsistent as all hell. But of course, after the Sweden trip, the Wings had a bit of a players' meeting after. And well, the results of that players' meeting speak for itself, because ever since the Wings have returned from Sweden, the Wings have gone on a hot streak and have now won 5 of their last 6, including 3 this week. Including 2 this week, as yeah, the Wings won 3 to fall last week when they responded with a shutout win over New Jersey, handing Boston their first regulation loss at home this year, which that's a good sight to see. They hand Boston that. And even beating Minnesota at home on last Sunday. And having Minnesota fire their head coach. So it's not just the Lions that are ending head coaches' careers now. Now the Red Wings are doing it too. As it seems like the Wings and the Lions are now getting to a pissing match here. Where the Wings and Yzerman are telling Brad Holmes and Dan Campbell, hey, whatever the Lions can do, we can do better. Now, whether that being better means playing down to competition, that's up in the air. But of course, the Wings' only loss in this streak was to the Rangers, which the Rangers are a pretty solid team, so nothing to be ashamed of there. The Wings almost came back in that game, but fell short. But what they didn't fall short was in the 2 wins, as they had a dominant win over Chatoilet, which that's something you have to see. Anytime you beat Chatoilet is a good day. And then Saturday, where the Wings gave the fan base almost a heart attack too, just doing their best Detroit Lions impersonation. Where on Saturday against Montreal, they jumped out to an early 3-goal lead, only to blow the lead and have the game tied 4-4 in the third and head to overtime. Only for the Wings in 53 seconds in to win. So yeah, all that effort from Montreal to make Detroit blow a 3-goal lead, only for the Wings to steal it in OT. Like, it's kind of sad that the Wings had to go to overtime against fucking Montreal. You know, they still got 2 points on the board. And then Jake Walman, once again, the gritty has returned, as Walman has done it again. So I'm going to have to update the intro to have the new gritty in there. As, yeah, Jake Walman did the gritty on Montreal's fucking corpse. And in Montreal's house, too, at the Bell Center. And especially, and this one's more satisfying than the Pittsburgh one. Considering that this one happened against a division rival, and it's one of the most hated original 6 rivals in the Canadiens. But yeah, the Wings are really proving that they belong too. And Steve Yzerman realized that what the flaw was on the roster. And the Wings needed to make a move. Damn, steely shit, Stevie. You didn't need to flex on the fan base that hard. But good God, holy shit, the Wings actually did it. They got Patrick Kane. I didn't think the Wings actually fucking do it, but they did. Of course, with the Wings bringing in Patrick Kane on a 1-year prove-it deal, after Patrick Kane coming off hip surgery, Of course, Kane didn't play at all this week. Kane's not expected to play either Tuesday or Thursday, but later this week. As Kane wanted to get adjusted in and all healed, all ready to go, and his conditioning and everything. But yeah, the Wayne's get another blue chip talent. As Kane still is one of the top players in the league. Even if he's not 100% from that hip injury, him at 50, 60, 70%, that would still make him better than the majority of the Wayne's roster. Because the Wayne's needed a player like Kane's status in this on the team. You know, a great compliment piece to Alex DeBrincat. And that's the main reason why Kane came here, was because he wanted to be with Alex DeBrincat, his old teammate from Chicago. So yeah, gonna be a bit weird seeing Patrick Kane in a Red Wings uniform, considering how many years I've had to see him wear a Chicago Blackhawks jersey for so many years, and now in a Red Wings uniform. Gonna be a bit weird at first, but I'll get used to it pretty quickly. Especially if Kane really picks up where he left off in Chicago. But yeah, all I say is Chicago fans can be salty as hell. And they are salty as hell because Kane just signed with Chicago's most hated rival. Chicago fans can get salty in CNUR week next week, bitches. But yeah. You know, the Wings, they made a big move and got Patrick Kane. You know, the Wayne's didn't twiddle their thumbs or anything, and they actually went and got somebody. Some of the Wayne's should have fucking done it the deadline, but didn't. I mean, this probably shows why Steve Yzerman is the top GM in Detroit right now over Brad Holmes. Like, honestly, I put Steve Yzerman over Brad Holmes at this point. I mean, draft-wise, they're both pretty dead even. But in terms of trade and signing free agents, I'd probably say Yzerman has the clear edge over Holmes, especially in the trade market, because Steve Yzerman knows how to fleece a bitch. But yeah, some of the Lions should have done. If anyone wants to say character issues or any of that, well, we're about to see if the character issues mean anything with Patrick Kane or not. I mean, if the culture is as good as you say it is, then the character issues shouldn't fucking matter and it should work itself out. Some food for thought there for Brad Holmes and Dan Campbell. I mean, hey, MCDC and Brad Holmes, if the Lions culture is as good as you say it is, go get somebody and prove it. If it's as good as you say it is, then the character issue should not be a problem and it should work itself out. But yeah, let's see how it works with Kane. I can't wait to see it. But yeah, I think this means the Red Wings are definitely a legit playoff contender. I mean, hey, maybe we'll get to see some playoff action at Little Caesars Arena after all this year. Because it sure as hell won't come from the Pistons this year. Who knows, maybe we'll have two Detroit teams in the playoffs this year. Man, the Wings are so fucking back and I love it. Man, I've been waiting a long time to see at least more than one good Detroit sports team. It's been a while. But good to see the Wayne wheel back where it belongs, near the top of the food chain. Now to the Lions and Saints game, and well, this game had started off really well for the Lions, as the Lions jumped out to a 21-0 lead at the blink of before you could even snap your fingers. Like, the moment you snapped your fingers, the Lions were already up 21-0 in a flash. Maybe with Montgomery having some moves to get in the end zone, then you have Brian Branch get an interception, then Amon-Ra with a touchdown, and Sam Laporta as well. Like, Sam Laporta had a fucking career game, as he continues to break rookie tight end records. Hawkins who? Who needs Hawkinson? We got Sam Laporta. Laporta better than Hawkinson anyway. And people want to talk about how the Lions trade Hawkinson was a bad idea. If anything, Laporta's the upgrade. Hawkinson's just a cheap Laporta knockoff. But then after that, the Lions just got complacent and the Saints were able to claw their way back. And it's like, you can't just jump out to an early lead and then just get complacent and play prevent. Like, you can't just do that. And it really showed, because the Saints were able to claw their way back in and go on a 21-3 run after that. Clawing their way back in. It's like, the Lions need to be aggressive for 60 minutes. Like, the Lions need to learn to keep their fucking foot in the gas pedal. because like there was a because deep down I knew the Saints were gonna come back, in which they didn't. And once the Saints got back, that's when the Lions put their foot back on the gas pedal and realized, oh shit, we actually gotta play now. Just, yeah, pretty frustrating, especially the second half. But, you know, despite that, you know, a pretty frustrating effort, especially with how the Lions started the game. But the Lions were able to find a way to finish the game strong and finish it out. You know, part of their great finish was because of Derek Carr getting injured, which that was a bad hit he took. That was just bad for him. And then we got Jameis Winston in at the game, in the game. And, well, after Jameis got the touchdown to cut the gap down, we then found out, will we get wild Jameis that usually throws a lot of turnovers, or will we get famous Jameis that can get that can put up solid numbers? We really didn't get either. We got somewhere in the middle where Jameis just threw a bunch of duds. It's like, that's the main reason why Jameis Winston isn't a starting QB in the league, and why he's Derek Carr's backup. Because Jameis Winston's just too inconsistent. One moment, he looks like a top QB that belongs here. Next moment, he looks like a fucking turnover machine. Like, Jameis just cannot be fucking consistent. Like, if you put a gun to my head and ask me what Jameis is gonna be this week, I can't fucking tell you, because I don't know what Jameis we're gonna get. But, you know, despite all that, you know, the Lions did what good teams do. Find a way to win a game. But let me be honest. SOL, the same old Lions, they would have found every single way to lose that game and blow that 21-point lead. But the brand new Lions always find ways to win games that other Lions teams from the past would have fucking lost. Like, in the end, though, this is just a testament to how underrated the Saints are. I think the Saints are a pretty underrated team, and I think a lot of people are sleeping on them. I think today showed, you know, just the Lions' defense needs to be fucking better. Like, they gotta make a bunch of adjustments, get more pressure to the QB. Secondary needs to be better. Just this defense has just gone downhill ever since that game against the Ravens. And just the Lions offense has been carrying the fucking defense the last month or so. Mainly just being able to outscore the other team simply. But yeah, just Aaron Glenn needs to get his shit together, especially for the second half. Because it seems like Aaron Glenn makes no fucking adjustments to the defense for the second half, even when they're getting shredded. Like, Aaron Glenn needs to learn how to make fucking adjustments and game plan better. Just pretty fucking pathetic there. But, you know, the Lions, you know, they were able to play a lot better. Even Goff played better in this game. I mean, Goff didn't turn the ball over for once, so there's a positive there. Lions even win the turnover battle, getting two key turnovers, though. But definitely, I'd say the player of the game for the Lions 100% is Laporta. Laporta is the fucking player of the game for the Lions. You know, but still, shout out to the Saints. You know, the Saints tried their hardest. They tried their hardest, but in the end, it just was not enough for the Saints. You know, Lions are able to find a way to seal the deal and finish the job. And now the Lions have secured back-to-back winning seasons again with a 9-3 record. And the Lions now extend their division lead over the Vikings by 3 games. Could potentially be 3 games over the Packers too, depending on what happens with the Sunday night game, which I'm watching it right now. And it's currently 14-12 Green Bay over Kansas City right now. Oh, I'm honestly hoping the Chiefs win. Even though I can't stand fucking Mahomes and the Chiefs and Taylor, especially with the NFL trying to shove Taylor Swift down everyone's throat, I'd rather have the Chiefs win over Green Bay on Sunday night. Even though I can't stand Mahomes and his fucking toxic family, I'd rather have the Chiefs over at Green Bay, to be honest. But, yeah. But yeah, you know, Lions, they will get the win. And now the Lions are off to their first 9-3 start since 1962. Last time Lions were at this point in the season, JFK was still present and the Beatles were still in their prime. Damn. Honestly, also, last time Lions were this good, no one in the Lions online football community was even alive at this point. I honestly be surprised if there are any Lions fans in this online community on YouTube that were alive back in 1962. It's been a while since the Lions were this damn good. And to think we had to sacrifice the Pistons for this. A soul for a soul. But yeah, like honestly, the Lions, they need to be like the Michigan Wolverines. They just need to keep their foot in the gas and not let anyone back in. But then again, you know, the Lions, you know, this game just proves why the Superdome is a hard place to play in. Even with Lions fans taking that bitch over, it was still a hard stadium to play in. But, you know, despite that, you know, a win's a win, I guess. You know, they're off to 9-3. And now the Lions' magic number to clinch the division is now 3. Plus, any combination of the Packers and Vikings losing helps that number out a lot better. Possibly drops it down, too. You know, just the Lions, you know, the Lions control their own destiny at this point. But with them at 9-3, it does mean one thing for sure. At bare worst, the Lions are at least going to be alive for a playoff spot in Week 18. Honestly, well, I hope it does get to that point. Like, the Lions just need to be aggressive, keep stacking wins, and try and clinch the North and get that home playoff game. Try and clinch that division title for the first time in 30 years. And honestly, this shoulder is kind of getting lonely here along with this belt. Because, yeah, this belt is definitely getting upgrade after Michigan won it their third straight Big Ten title. Of course, you know, the job's far from done there yet. You know, we still, you know, with the college football Final Four. I'll be honest, for that Final Four, Alabama should not be in the Final Four. It should be Michigan, Washington, FSU, and Texas in that order. Florida State got fucking snubbed from the Final Four. Like, seriously, how the fuck do you go 13-0, win your conference title, and not even be in the top college football playoffs? Honestly, with Bama, with the NCAA favoritism for Bama getting Bama in over Florida State, honestly, that whole thing just makes me glad and that next year the college football playoffs is expanding to 12 teams next year, so we hopefully don't have to deal with this bullshit no more. But yeah. You know, but hey, Michigan on New Year's Day has a chance to finally put that overrated Bama team to rest once and for all. But yeah, and yeah, this shoulder's getting lonely. I think I want to add an NFC North title to the other shoulder once we get the new belt in and get it updated. But yeah, I honestly say get used to seeing some belts on this shoulder, because I have a gut feeling you're going to be seeing a lot more belts on the shoulders. A lot more belts, as now it's trophy hunting season, baby. Not only in NFL, but NCAA as well. And who knows, maybe the Red Wings can get another belt on there too. But yeah, it's time to go trophy hunting and get some belt hunting. But yeah, I'm going to wrap this up. Lions get the win, go to 9-3, 33-28. Wasn't a pretty win, but the Lions were able to survive and weather the storm against the Saints. And they go to 9-3. Don't have to be pretty, but they got the job done and finished it. But yeah, and the Lions also sweep the NFC South for the first time in God knows how long. I can't recall the last time the Lions ever swept the NFC South. I can't recall a time like that when the Lions just swept the division. Who knows? And also, in a couple weeks, the Lions have a chance to possibly sweep another division on a Saturday night. Yes, Saturday night against the Broncos in 2 weeks. Here we come, baby. Detroit get another primetime game at Ford Field. Gotta love it. But yeah, anyway, before we get to Denver, though, on that Saturday night game, we got Chicago next week for War Week Round 2. Which, there is no hate week for Chicago next week. I only did one hate week this week, and that was week 11. But anyway, that'll wrap it up here on the Chicago next week, and I'm out. Actually, though, before I go and really wrap this up, though, I do want to give a shout-out and congratulations to former Detroit Tigers manager Jim Leland, as he has been officially elected to the National Baseball Hall of Fame class of 2024. So congrats to Jim Leland on that one. Well deserved by him. You know, very great manager for the Tigers. Even got into a couple World Series, you know. You know, very great honor for him. You know, well deserved for Jim Leland. So yeah, congrats to him there. About fucking time he got in the Hall of Fame. Thank God. About fucking time, baby. I'm out.